Across America and around the world, you're listening to the Hour of the Time. This is the only hour that ever was or ever will be. This is the most important hour in your entire life. For ladies and gentlemen, during this hour, you will decide your future and thus our collective futures. I'm your host, William Cooper, and tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we have on the other end of this telephone, waiting on hold, a guest that is going to put the doubt away from your mind about something that you've wondered about since February the 28th, 1993. When I revealed on this radio program that the members of the church known as Branch Davidian were murdered, many of you wrote, some of you called, you expressed your total and complete disbelief. And I certainly sympathized with you, for we've been taught all our lives that nothing like this could ever happen in the United States of America. You said, though, that if you saw it with your own eyes, you would believe it. Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest tonight is Linda Thompson. She has put together a videotape that will enable you to see with your own eyes how the congregation of the church known as Branch Davidian was in fact murdered. Murdered by the very people whom we've entrusted with our safekeeping, with our security, with the security of the nation. And you will discover that they are in fact liars, criminals, godless traitors. And I mean that with all of the emotion and all of the meaning that those words invoke. We've reached an agreement with Linda Thompson, ladies and gentlemen, to split the cost, and she is forwarding us a 3/4-inch master of this videotape, and you can order the tape directly from us. Make checks out to William Cooper, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona 85901. That's P.O. Box 1420. Sholo, spelled S-H-O-W-L-O-W, Arizona, 85901. The price of the tape is $20. Please enclose $5 for postage and handling. And as soon as we receive your order, folks, the tape will be in the mail to you within 24 hours. We guarantee it. We must get this tape into as many American hands as we possibly can and to everyone else around the world who understands what is happening. And especially if you understand, those of you not living in this country, that your freedom hinges on our efforts to remain free, then you need to see this video also. Don't go away, folks, for tonight on the Hour of the Time, we're going to light our own fire.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like for you to welcome to the Hour of the Time, Linda Thompson. Linda, in my estimation, is a real American hero. She's put herself in harm's way by making this video that we talked about last Friday night on this program on Waco, Texas. And I've invited her on this show to tell us how she got where she is, why she made this video, what it shows in this video, and what she hopes to accomplish by this. And if we don't get everything discussed during this hour, the Hour of the Time, we'll bring her back tomorrow night and the night after, as long as it takes. And some point along here, we want to get into discussing a legal, constitutional militia of the people, but we don't want to do that until we've covered all the other bases. Linda, would you please give us some of your background? Tell us who you are, where you came from, what your education is, and how you got to the point where you're at right now talking to me on this radio show.
Sure. I'm an attorney. I went to Indiana University Law School. And before that, I had, and I went pretty much late in life. I was in my early 30s when I went to law school. Before that, I had been a homemaker, stayed at home with my children when they were young. I had been a janitor, and I'd been a secretary and a word processing supervisor. And other than that, let's see, I'd been in the Army. I was in the Army from 74 to 78. And to get to this point now, when I graduated law school, I immediately began getting cases that were pretty much high-profile cases, it was a fluke, but the cases invariably were ones that had a lot of interest from the public, and that brought more and more people to me that began to see me as a fighter for the underdog, so to speak. And in the process of taking those kinds of cases, I began to see that our courts were not what they were supposed to be, that attorneys are supposed to play by these set of rules, and the rules change daily, that the courts are pretty much writing the rules as they go along, and they're not following the Constitution at all. And I also discovered that it takes a lot of work to determine that our courts aren't operating constitutionally, because you first have to have a good understanding of the Constitution, which isn't taught in law school. It isn't taught in our public school system either.
Now, when I was a boy, it used to be taught in school. In fact, the states used to teach their state history and have courses and teach the Constitution, and specifically in high school. But they don't do that anymore. And CAGI, the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, did investigate the required reading list for 16 major law schools in the United States, and we found that the Constitution is not on their required reading list.
Yeah. And what little bit they do teach, there is a constitutional law class, for instance, at IU, but they concentrate on two or three specific points of the Constitution without ever getting into the history of the Constitution or the meaning of any of the various articles of the Constitution or most of the amendments to the Constitution. So you come out of there with absolutely no grasp of the significance of the Constitution to our law in this country. Anyway, what really got me started was Randy Weaver's situation, because my husband and I had started an electronic news network in response to the cases I was having, where people would be beaten up by federal agents or police or have their houses seized, or different horrible things were happening to people all over the country. And it was almost like a steamroller. It was impossible to stop. I would get these kinds of cases and just wring my hands, because you would know that the feds could do these kinds of things to people and get away with it. And the public wasn't screaming about it. In fact, more laws were being passed that were even worse than the ones we were dealing with. So we started a network to publish some of these cases that were happening around the country, because I didn't think the American public had a clue. And I was right, because these aren't appearing in the major media. And Randy Weaver's story is a real good example, because very few people even heard about him when this was going on, and yet in his case, the governor declared martial law. They had tanks in the yard. They had ATF agents keeping neighbors away with machine guns. They did a lot of things. They did almost everything to Weaver that they did in Waco, and there was not a big bunch of publicity going along with it. And what you did see was white supremacists holed up in mountain cabins at keeping feds at bay, you know, or murdering feds, you know, that kind of thing. Complete disinformation.
And even though an awful lot of people showed up in support of Randy Weaver, the only ones that the news media portrayed were the small group of skinheads, and invariably within this group of skinheads, bug rights could be found. But go ahead with your progressive...
It was the thing that astonished me was these are... I called up, I talked to the local police there, I talked to Chuck Sandlin, who was a guy who went up there, I talked to some of the neighbors, and I was getting all this information that was completely different than what the news was reporting. I mean, the neighbors weren't all racist, they weren't all skinheads, they weren't all crazy people, and they'd been kicked out of their houses. And most of the people were holding back, thinking, well, we don't have the whole story here, this is a fluke, something's not right, it doesn't make sense that, you know, that the feds would do this kind of thing to somebody. Well, now that the trial's over, we know that they did do that. They did everything Randy Weaver said they did and more. And they did it with a vengeance.
Not only did it, but lied about everything, and intentionally during the trial lied to the jury and to the judge.
Yeah.
But their lies, fortunately, were so blatant and so easily proven to be lies that the resultant verdict was certainly in the favor of Randy Weaver, and of course that's a great reflection on the intelligence of the jury, who somewhere along the line learned something about what a jury should be, or else they would have obeyed the judge's instructions and brought in guilty verdicts on all of the charges.
Yeah, and the jury there, I'm so proud that our jury system worked in that particular case, and that Gary Spence did the excellent job he did, because he did everything on direct examination, not on cross. And that is the hallmark of a masterful attorney. He's one of the last true heroes left. But in any event, I had made a vow. I knew what the truth was, you know, well before there was ever a trial, and a lot of people knew what the truth was before there was ever a trial. And I had said that if this ever happens again, I'm not going to stand by and do nothing. Because being an attorney and having gotten a lot of media attention with some of my cases, I knew that I could bring media and focus on the issue if it came up again. You know, one of the things I thought was a problem with Weaver's case was he didn't get any media. Well, I was wrong, because Waco got a ton of media. But in the Waco case, the media not only was reporting lies, they were helping cover up the truth.
And in many instances, the media was responsible for some of the lies.
Yeah.
In other words, when we monitor all of the press conferences and the official news releases, the press sometimes added things that did not exist even in those press conferences and news releases. Even as bad as they were and as many lies as they perpetrated, the media was adding lie up on top of lie on top of those lies.
There was a concerted campaign. The Waco Tribune Herald came out with articles about David Koresh and the Branch Davidians before the initial assault. And that whole thing was full of nothing but lies and innuendo and insinuations. It's the kind of stuff you'd expect to see in the National Enquirer or the Sun or the Globe. It wasn't something that should have ever even been attempted in a newspaper of any kind of, that claimed any credibility anyway. And yet, the feds then attacked on the 28th and claimed they had moved it up a day because of this news article in the Waco Tribune. Well, that was a lie, because I had the warrant, and their warrant expired on the 28th, and that's the day they attacked, was the 28th.
In other words, if they had not attacked on the 28th, they could not have attacked at all.
Right. And I believe that this media blitz that occurred ahead of time was part and parcel. I believe they planned that they wanted the Branch Davidians to have prior notice. In fact, I've got a news release where Sharon Wheeler with the ATF is quoted as having called the press herself, you know, to tell them.
Mm-hmm.
And so that I believe that this was organized in advance, that they wanted the Branch Davidians to know they were coming, and they wanted them to fight back, and they intended for the ATF to go in their usual thug and goon manner, get in there, assault them, the Branch Davidians would fight back, there'd be a big massacre, and they could kill them all right then.
Well, we know that was their intent to begin with.
It didn't happen because the Branch Davidians didn't fight back enough. They hardly fought back at all.
That's right, and we're going to get into that, because that's what your video shows very clearly. That's what all of the videotape that we have shows. And we were in the process of putting together our own video, and we've just put all of that on the shelf because you beat us to it, and you did a wonderful job, and we decide it's more important that the people get a video, any video, no matter who made it, showing what really happened into their hands, rather than wait for us to make one. But the point I want to make is that all of this had to be planned beforehand, because they confessed themselves that they had been rehearsing for months. And at the same time, even before they made the raid on the 28th, there was a movie set that was being built in the state of Oklahoma to film the movie of Branch Davidian and the raid. And, of course, we saw that as a movie of the week on television.
NBC, and if anybody, NBC is also the station that rigged the blown-up trucks. You remember that?
Yes, and that was totally false.
Okay, so anybody that takes anything NBC says now as truth is an idiot.
Well, we go farther on this program. We tell our listening audience not to believe anything unless they can verify it for themselves. And I'm going to tell you how to verify it, folks. When you get this video that Linda Thompson has made, and by the way, Linda and I have discussed this, you can order it directly from us at the very same price that you would order it from her. So you've got two sources, and she has told me that she would rather you order it from us because they don't have time to produce these things. So whichever you wish to do, you have that choice. But in her video, you can clearly see that the Branch Davidians did not shoot back. In fact, did not shoot at all that we could determine in this video. And but in the NBC movie, it shows that as soon as the federal officers approached the building All of a sudden, holes started appearing in the plywood walls of the building as the Branch Davidians were firing with powerful weapons through their own walls, killing federal officers. All this was a lie. And in the real video footage of the real attack on the real Branch Davidian church, you can see this for yourself. And that's what we want you to do. Get a copy of the movie of the week. I'm sure many people taped it. Pretty soon, I'm sure that if it's not already, it will be in the video stores. Get Linda Thompson's video and compare the two for yourself, and you'll see how the American public has been propagandized, lied to support this illegal action, and how we can all be duped by the television networks and television in general. Now, you know, if an entire network is perpetrating a lie, in this instance, that you'd better be very careful about anything you believe from any news source.
I have one little correction so that we're not incredible ourselves. I think the Branch Davidians did shoot back some, but that was not until after they'd already been attacked. All the shooting scenes you see with the ATF standing at their car shooting bullet after bullet after bullet, and these guys have already broken in the window. There's at least one shot fired out the roof that doesn't hit anybody, that I can't attribute to anybody but the Branch Davidians, because it's from inside a room.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the shots that come out of that one wall that don't hit anybody could either be agents inside the room or a Branch Davidian, so we don't know for sure. But regardless, those shots didn't hit anybody either.
That's true. But what the point I was making was not that they didn't shoot back. The point that I was making is that we couldn't determine that they shot back by looking at the video. Any of the video footage, we can't tell who is actually shooting. But we can tell that what they portrayed in the NBC movie of the week was a total lie.
Yeah,
none of that happened.
When those guys are, all the ATF agents are standing behind the cars, they're pumping bullets into that house, and there's not a single bullet being fired at them. You know, none of their windshields are being hit. The ground isn't being hit. None of the windows in the house are open or broken. Nothing. There's no indication at all that the Branch Davidians are shooting back at that point.
That's
true. They're being fired upon heavily,
mm-hmm.
and they're not firing back. And then the 911 tapes substantiate that.
Well, let's continue where you left off, Linda. And why did you go? Why and when did you go to Waco?
Well, I went to Waco the first time in March, about the 19th. And I was trying to get down there sooner, but I didn't have the money. And I went because at that point they had not allowed any attorney into the Branch Davidian's house with them, and they were all surrounded at that point by tanks and barbed wire and federal agents, and this was an atrocity. And there's no shortage of attorneys in Texas, and I was not hearing any of the attorneys screaming about how illegal this was. I wasn't seeing anybody doing anything. And you have an absolute right. You've got a Sixth Amendment right to counsel, but when you're arrested, you've got a Fifth Amendment right to counsel. It's due process. There's Supreme Court cases that support that out the wazoo.
Now, were these people considered arrested when the siege began?
When you're no longer free to leave police control, you're arrested. Whether they officially arrest you or not, if you can't leave the control of the police voluntarily, which I think you could agree that was the situation when you're surrounded by tanks and police and feds and everything else, then, I mean, it doesn't get any clearer than the situation they had. They were not free to leave. You know, yeah, they could leave, but they would leave to the immediate custody of the very people that had them surrounded.
Sure.
So they were not free to leave, and they are then, by federal law and by Supreme Court cases, under arrest. Well,
mm-hmm.
once you are under arrest like that, you're entitled to counsel. And no one was griping about that. I mean, these guys needed someone to come in and say, yeah, here's your rights, here's what's going to happen to you if you go out, here's what's going to happen to you if you stay in, these kinds of things.
But Linda, these are people who were going to commit mass suicide. They were said to be terrorists, they were said to be child molesters, child abusers. The leader of this group said that he was Jesus Christ. Why should they have rights?
Well, first of all, everything you just said there is something that the media said that we've never seen any evidence of at all. I've talked to all of the family. The Texas authorities had investigated the child abuse charges and the automatic rifle things twice and found nothing in 2 years.
And we could substantiate that because I personally talked to the child welfare people and the local sheriff, when I was in Waco, Texas, and they verified to me personally what Linda has just told you.
And that's right in the warrant, too. And the other thing is, you can check with Henry McMahon. He ran Hewitt Arms at the gun store in Waco, or was at the time. The Branch Davidians bought their guns from him. The ATF had been to Henry McMahon's store 8 months ago and checked all of his records and found out they bought all these guns legally. He had all the required paperwork there. And he even called Koresh on the phone and said, hey, the ATF's got a problem with you guys buying all these guns. And Koresh said, well, tell them to come on out. And they didn't go. The ATF did not take him up on the offer then. And yet they knew those guns were legally purchased. And in the warrant, they still said, we've got all this information that all this stuff is illegal. Well, that was a lie. It was a flat lie. Same thing with the child abuse and sex molesting charges and all that. Those things had already been investigated for 2 years. The ATF had no jurisdiction to investigate it anyway, even if every bit of that was true.
That's correct. And they had,
the ATF doesn't have any jurisdiction.
That's correct. And they had no jurisdiction for the stated reason that they made the raid in their press conference on the 28th, which was that they had heard from a foreign informant through the State Department that they were going to commit mass suicide. That was the first reason given. And I don't even know if there's a federal law against suicide anyway. Do you?
Well, there's not. And there's also no authority for any federal agency to come in on a completely state crime. For instance, if you litter in Texas, the ATF can't come arrest you. It has nothing to do with the ATF. And suicide, a planned mass suicide, first of all, that was another lie. I've talked to every one of the surviving Branch Davidians. Those people are as sane as anyone.
Yes, it was a lie, and we traced it down, and we were the first ones to reveal on this radio show that that charge originated with the Cult Awareness Network.
Yeah, and Cult Awareness Network is something that a lot of people should look into, because those, if you want to talk about an evil cult, Cult Awareness Network.
They are a cult themselves,
in fact. They fit the bill to a T, because they are evil. They've caused people to be killed. They've caused people to be murdered. And they've taken people's children from them. They've gotten international agencies to just go in and seize families' children on no more than their allegations. And they're horrible. This Cult Awareness Network needs to be taken down.
There's a lot more to all this than what meets the eye. On the board of directors and at the highest echelon of the Cult Awareness Network are people who participated in secret mind control operations such as MKUltra with the Central Intelligence Agency. And we know that a lot of their funding comes from spy organizations, which have been proven to be a spy organization and are being indicted right now for spying within this country and transporting information to foreign countries. And I'm talking about the Anti-Defamation League, the ADL.
I've got a lawsuit that's going to be filed against these people next week on behalf of another religious group in California, making exactly those allegations, and we can substantiate them. So this Rick Ross, a number of the Cult Awareness people were on TV the night that Mount Carmel burned down. These guys suddenly pop up out of the woodwork, you know, everywhere. Any station you turned on, there was a member of Cult Awareness Network, and there was a so-called expert on cults and so-called deprogrammer. Well, first of all, tell me where you get a degree to become an expert in cults. Secondly, tell me where you get training to be a deprogrammer. These guys are self-proclaimed, okay? They're nobody.
That's probably the same place that you get the designation ufologist. I'm sorry, I mean ufologist. But go ahead.
Now, this Rick Ross was on TV. He was a talking head. He was the guy advising the ATF all along for 30 days. Well, he was just indicted last week for kidnapping and a lot of other felony charges. And this is the kind of, this is the caliber of people that our government was dealing with, helping them to promulgate all these lies about the Branch Davidians in the press to keep everybody's attention distracted from what they were really doing.
Mm-hmm.
They went in there to kill these people to begin with.
Absolutely. And we said that on this radio show during the siege, that if it was not stopped, those people would be murdered.
And it backfired when they didn't fight back hard enough so that they could kill them all the first day. And then they had to figure out a way to do it in front of the public and get away with it. And they did. They absolutely did. And the tape that we produced shows how the government did it. They
shows it so well that it gave me chills. It brought tears to my eyes. I was in a rage for hours. I had to control myself. What I wanted to do was get a gun and go off and start the war, and I'm glad that I didn't, and I advise everybody else to control themselves also well, see this video, it will have that effect on you.
I've had to fight that all throughout this because I've been finding all this information, and I've had to fight that urge so many times I couldn't tell you. I got a hit list a mile long, you know, and it just, it doesn't stop. I mean, it gets worse by the day. I find out more and more and more. But the most damning piece, this video was put together so that the average person who really has doubts that we've got evil people leading this government, people that will not stop at anything, and I mean anybody that will murder babies.
Godless people.
These are truly godless people that will literally stop at nothing in their quest for power, and I guarantee this video proves it. I absolutely guarantee it. And
why don't you continue the way you're going, and then after the break we'll talk about what's in the video. So how did you get this footage? Where did you get this footage from?
All over the place. Originally, there was a fellow down in Texas with the CFA that he had taken a lot of the footage off of a satellite, and we were going to use his footage because he was sending copies to us. But the copies that we've got were really horrible quality. They were recorded in slow play. Well, in the meantime, he and CFA were going to make their own video, so we sent all the donations we got for American Justice, we sent them down to them to get their video made.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when they got their video made, I was going to take it to Congress. Well, I was so disappointed in their video.
Yes, it is disappointing, and there's some outright blatant inaccuracies in there.
Yeah, it's just completely wrong.
Yeah.
And there was no change in their opinion, and I just said, well, we got to make our own.
And we went down
and we got some of this footage from the guy. But again, he recorded it in slow play, so it was useless, and it sent me out on a quest to get it from other places. So I called. There are services that just tape record news broadcasts and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
We started paying to order all that footage from all over the country, any place we could get it, from news services that would release, you know, what they had. But what I found was, for the most part, these places either keep footage for 30 days and destroy it or 90 days and destroy it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that most of the footage from the 28th was already gone. But I found this one service that they said, well, we've got a lot of stuff from the 19th. And it's going to cost you several thousand dollars because we charge per segment. I said, well, we're about out of money. I don't think we can afford that. Well, this lady called me back from there a few minutes later. She said, well, you know, we were just getting ready to recycle these tapes today anyway. So if you'll just pay me the cost of the tapes, I'll send you my original. And I said, sure. Well, this fire footage was on those tapes.
Folks, it's time to take our break. Don't go away. We'll be right back after this very short pause.
Now, if that wasn't God's hand, I don't know what was, because we didn't get that footage anywhere else. And yet, since we've put the tape out, we've had several people contact us and say, yeah, I saw this on TV the day of the fire, and I couldn't believe it.
That's right. We have most of the footage here ourselves. CAGI members were taping it, and they know better than to tape it on slow. And we were in the process of writing scripts and getting ready to edit. There is one clip of film that we did not have, and that was the clip of the film of the agent on top of the roof, who apparently had just emerged from one of the windows, was sitting on the edge of the roof, and jumped down and removed a hood off of his head and then calmly walked away, which is just a staggering piece of footage, not to mention, you know, the rest of it. The whole film is staggering, but you certainly did a wonderful job, and the clarity and the quality of the videotape is very good.
Now, do you guys have the fire footage, too?
We have the fire footage, too.
Oh, praise the Lord. This is great, because we need to find that footage from as many places as possible, because the only place that showed it on national TV,
mm-hmm.
Well, it wasn't even national, it was up in Chicago, they were going to show it three nights in a row, and they showed it one night, and then the second day they called the FBI. For their comments, and guess what the FBI's first comment was? You remember the old swamp gas from the 60s?
Yes. It's the swamp gas.
That's what it reminded me of, but their comment was, oh, that wasn't fire, it was a glare from the gas, which is absolute baloney. I mean, you can see it plainly.
No, this is no glare. Anybody who's been in the military, I've been in the military, I've seen tanks with flamethrowers. This is a tank with a flamethrower. And anyone who's ever been in the military, who's ever seen a tank with a flamethrower, will recognize it immediately. In fact, if you've never been in the military and never seen a flamethrower, you will still recognize it immediately as a flamethrower.
Yeah, well, then the second comment was, or else I altered the footage. Now, let me just tell you this. I told you I got this from the service.
Uh-huh.
They taped two different broadcasts on the same channel that night, and this footage is on both broadcasts. and I've got the whole broadcast,
mm-hmm.
okay, you know, on our tape,
mm-hmm.
it would be impossible for me to monkey with those tapes and come up with an entire news broadcast, right?
That's correct.
And still put it on our tapes.
Our people taped it directly off the KU band, the news feeds, and not from the local news, our local news broadcast. This came directly from the satellite news feeds, directly from Waco, Texas, as it was happening. So
we need it from as many sources as possible, but I do know that the station, once the FBI said this, they kind of got hostile to it and said they were going to have it authenticated. Well, they sent it to an FBI forensic examiner, a guy that used to be in the FBI, and his credentials just are incredible. They're impeccable. He's got pages and pages of experience and some of the, you know, best training I've ever seen. If I needed an expert, he would definitely be a good one to pick.
Uh-huh.
Well, they sent the tape over to him, and I didn't know him. I mean, they picked him. He calls me, then he looked at their copy of the tape, and he said, well, it's a fourth-generation copy, so it's, you know, I can't absolutely say that it hasn't been altered, but it should show signs of altering even on a copy, and he says there's absolutely none, and he was so convinced it was real that he's now helping us. He sent me all kinds of information from inside the feds, you know, and things like that. So
fantastic. But what you should get him to do, you should bring him in to examine the original and have him write an affidavit as to its authenticity before he changes his mind.
Okay, well, he won't. But the problem is money.
We've heard that before.
Right. The problem is money, because the TV station, after they questioned the authenticity,
uh-huh.
sent the tape over to him, they won't pay him. Okay, and for him to do it, he said he has to rent some equipment that's $2,000, plus he charges a fairly hefty sum per hour, and he said he would work at a very discounted rate for us, but we're still looking at somewhere between $3,000 and $5,000 for him to authenticate these tapes, and I don't have it. I mean, I went completely broke doing this. I've spent close to $30,000 on investigation, traveling back and forth to Waco, paying for these tapes, paying the studio that made the video for us. The video alone was about $11,000.
Well, I'll tell you what, we'll work on that, because it's important that it's authenticated. We know that it's real because we have the footage, you have the footage, you've made the film, other people have the footage. There were literally hundreds of people across this country, maybe thousands, taping it raw from the satellite feed on the KU bands, and it's everywhere.
Yeah,
it's literally everywhere.
We're not making money off the tapes either, because we figured that
no.
out. Every tape we've gotten an order on, we've sent out two or three free ones, because I sent them to the House and Senate Judiciary Committee members, Reno, and everybody in the executive branch that has anything to do with it, all the independent investigators, the Texas Rangers, the McLennan County Sheriff. I sent them to any place that could possibly have anything to do with investigating.
Okay, I hate to interrupt you, Linda, but I've got to. Linda, I want you to tell us now, everybody's out there waiting, sitting on the edge of their chairs. They've heard it from me. Now they want to hear it from you. What's in this videotape?
Oh, well, there's a little background on the Branch Davidians, but the most, I think, damning part and most important parts of the tape, first and foremost, shows that the government and the media lied, because there was a tank, it was a flame-throwing tank. It goes in the holes in the side of the house, sets a fire, and backs out. And you can see the flame on that tank very plainly.
Not only the flame, but you can see the nozzle of the flamethrower. You can see the flame shooting out from that nozzle. And what else?
The other thing is, you know, they claim to have started all this at 6 in the morning. Well, that was a lie. I've got 2 hours of satellite feed before 6 o'clock in the morning. They've already knocked the house off its foundation at one end of the building, and there's a big hole there in that end of the building. And
this is right after sunrise, is that correct?
Yeah, this is somewhere between 4:30 and 6 in the morning.
Okay.
And there's a tank that sits over this one end of the house for that whole 2 hours, and guys get in and out of that tank. Well, where that tank is over the underground tunnel. Now, it also shows there was a release in the London Times.
Well, wait a minute, Linda, before you go on. You're not used to radio. I am. Everybody's sitting out there, they're thinking, what underground tunnel? What is she talking about?
Okay, out in the yard, the Branch Davidians were building a storm shelter, and what they kept calling bunkers was actually a storm shelter that they had planned to build because they have tornadoes in Texas. And as they were building it, it had gotten rained on, so they never finished most of it. The parts of it were finished. One part was a tunnel that ran from one end of the building out to these underground shelters. And that tunnel is what also was called the bus a lot of times. I think you might have heard that in the media. Anyway, it was a pretty decent little structure, cement structure underground. Well, this tank is sitting over that for 2 hours in the morning. And there was a trap door in the end of the building that led to that underground tunnel. The very first place that any smoke or gas or anything is seen is actually seen coming up out of the ground before 6 o'clock in the morning out of that tunnel.
And it was quite a bit of smoke.
There's a lot of it. And the media never even mentioned it, okay? And then the very first place that the tank hits is right there over that trap door. They go in and just literally collapse the trap door or the house over that trap door so that anybody that was in that underground tunnel, when it's on fire or smoking or whatever it's doing, they're not going to get out. They're going to die. But what they were doing was making sure that if anybody was in there, they were going to be dead and they weren't going to get out. And that's why they were doing, that's why they attacked that end of the building first. And it goes to motive. I think it very strongly proves, you know, they intended to kill everybody. They started with the tunnel first, they gassed it, they shot incendiaries down in it, and they collapsed the trap door on it so nobody could get out or in.
Okay, but the point I'm trying to make is the release to the news media after the church had been burned and the building had collapsed and everything was that most of the bodies that they found were in what they called the bunker.
Yeah.
And they were not talking about the concrete house that stood up above the rubble. They wanted us to believe that, but that's not really where most of the bodies were found at all.
Yeah, and you can see in the footage where they're taking some of the bodies out, and they were not where they're claiming.
Right. That was the point I was trying to make. Go ahead, Linda.
And then after they collapse this hole into the building down on the trap doors, there's tanks that go and bash. Basically, if you're looking at the front of the house, there's three holes that were made in the front of that house. But what they didn't let you know was that it was made by more than one tank. They had two or three different tanks hit the same hole. And so that by the time the live footage was, while the live footage was rolling, a tank would hit a hole, and then all of a sudden they'd cut away to some stupid interview at the hospital with somebody standing there saying, well, nothing's happened here yet. You know, then they'd cut back, and you'd see a tank backing out of the hole, but what you didn't realize was it was a different tank.
That's correct, yes.
And so there was actually two and three different tanks hit each one of these holes, and we had to go through a lot of footage to figure that out. And that's how we found how they perpetrated this fraud on us, was the times they were cutting away to the hospital, this is what was going on. A fire-shooting tank was going in that hole, setting the house on fire, and coming out. And also, the holes that they chose to make initially collapsed all the stairwells in the house, so that anybody that was still alive was going to be burned alive.
Right, and the ones who were trapped upstairs could not have any way out except through windows, which would make them perfect targets for snipers.
And that's where the footage with the guy on the roof comes into play. I wish I had put in another little piece that we had, and I didn't. It's before what you see with the guy on the roof taking his suit off and jumping down. What he was doing beforehand is he's laying on that roof pointing a rifle at the window.
Wow.
And then he gets up, he takes off his Nomex suit while he's on the roof, he jumps down, he throws the suit down, he walks off, he takes his hood off.
Yeah, that you can see plainly in the visible, in the video. It's not like looking out your window and watching somebody in your backyard, but you can see it.
And another thing I thought was really damning was we got this information from the London Times.
We have that article also.
Yeah, the FBI had put little transmitters along the sides of the house. And people ask me, well, how did they do that? Well, this whole story about them being afraid of the Branch Davidian shooting at them was a lie. We've got footage showing them all throughout this thing walking around the house. They weren't scared of these guys.
That's right.
They would take a tank around the house, and if anybody came to the window, they'd charge the window with this tank and scare them away from the window. So the Branch Davidians literally were scared captives in that house. They weren't trying to do anything. So the FBI put these little fiber optic transmitters all along the outside of the house and in the air vents that had little tiny fiber optic cameras, just like they use for arthroscopic surgery, that they could see through the walls into the walls of the house with a little probe. It was attached to a transmitter that transmitted the signal to a remote television. The FBI could see and hear everything these guys did all the time. They knew where those people were in that building. They also had British Secret Service sent a plane over to thermal image the house to tell them by body heat where those people were.
Well, let's clarify that. It wasn't British Secret Service.
That's
it was
right.
British Special Air Services. which is an equivalent organization to, which would be equivalent to something like the Central Intelligence Agency. It's not MI6, it's not MI5, but it is even a more secret, more clandestine secret organization that actually came out of World War II and during that time was known as the Special Air Services.
And why that is also significant is, with the footage of the guy jumping off the roof and walking away, there's a Branch Davidian who is not a Branch Davidian. He's British, and I believe he is a British SAS agent, who is trying to provide a cover story for that, saying, oh, it was me. And when I interviewed him, his story was so completely rehearsed. He said, well, I was on the roof, I rolled over a couple of times, I jumped down, I did this, I did that. I mean, it was, I'm an attorney, I recognize a rehearsed witness when I see one.
Well, not only that, what happened with this guy that came off the roof was not, I repeat, a Branch Davidian, and was not consistent with anything that they have done when a Branch Davidian has ever emerged from that building.
Absolutely, but what's interesting is they didn't realize how much of this was caught on camera. This guy's story was consistent with what was shown live, but it wasn't consistent with all this other footage that you see in my video, because the camera that was live cut away. When it would show the guy on the roof, as soon as they would see him, he would cut away. So there was an agent running this main camera that all the stations were using. And as one guy pointed out, you know, the stations are usually very competitive. They'll sell their own grandmother to get a story. And yet they were all using the same camera, mm-hmm. the same camera angle that day. I thought it was really interesting, and that began to be a way that we could tell something happened. If the camera moved away, I went looking for footage for what it moved away from, because invariably it was something the government was up to.
Sure.
And that's how we got this footage, showing the guy jumping off and walking away.
You know, up until a Desert Storm, the media had, up until that time, that we could tell. I mean, if they really wanted to go and take footage or do something, they could. And Desert Storm was the first time that we could really perceive the complete control over the media that they had there. And the second time was even more control than anything we've ever seen in this country before, and that was Waco, Texas. Unbelievable control over the media, to the point where if you ask a question that they did not want you to ask, you were removed from the press conference.
Absolutely. You were barred from the press conference, and in two cases, you were arrested.
That's correct. Just for asking a question.
Yeah. We weren't allowed in the press conferences at all, and I have press credentials, and they wouldn't let me in, period. And that was why they staged that. They stopped us and seized our credentials at a roadblock.
Uh-huh.
Because they didn't want me to come in.
Well, one of our people lost his press credentials also, and the rest of us, they did not bother, mainly because they didn't know who we were, and we knew better than to ask those questions if we wanted to stay. And it wasn't the fact that the questions needed to be asked or didn't need to be asked. We needed to be there to do the investigations that we needed to do to bring you these broadcasts that we're bringing. It is to the very, very complete and utter shame of the established media that they were the cowards that they were and would not ask the questions that needed to be asked, nor would they report what the questions were that were asked that got these other people thrown out of the press conference.
Yeah.
Isn't that incredible?
Well, that to me was as scary as anything, is that our media, now, was so completely controlled, and they're not only controlled while it was going on, they're controlled now because they had this footage same as I do, you know, same as you do.
That's right.
They had the footage, and they didn't show it to the American public, and then when I sent them this videotape with the footage in it, free, and called it to their attention just in case they missed it, because there was a lot of footage. I gave them the benefit of the doubt, figuring, well, the reporters were not where the cameras were the day this was going on. They could not see what the cameras were seeing.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, well, maybe they just didn't see it. I sent it to them. They still won't show it. They still will not broadcast this on TV. And then the one place...
They won't even broadcast it with a disclaimer, will they?
No, and then one place in Chicago that did show it, they shut down the broadcast in it after the second night with their contact with the FBI. Then my local station here, and these media guys here in Indianapolis, they know me. They've done a lot of stories on cases I've had. They know I'm not some kind of fruitcake. All the stories up until now have always been very positive. The media's been very kind to me. And all of a sudden, I get this guy that's really hot to do this story, and we had it set up. He comes out to run, you know, to see the footage. And says the producer cut him off at the knees.
Linda, that has happened to me on almost everything I've ever tried to do with the media.
Well, but see, I've got a working history with these guys. These are guys that know me. They know I'm not a flake.
Yeah, but you were working with them on things that were not of the nature that we're talking about now. I've always been working with this kind of stuff that we're talking about now, and that's why I have never had any success.
But this is the thing that was so shocking, because he told me, you know, that the producer said, no story. We've been told by the powers that be not to do a story. I had a journalist from the Star News come over to just for the purpose of telling me that there was at least one editor and one journalist there that has been there a real long time. The journalist is being paid and the editor is cooperating. They have been told to trash me in the paper.
Now, I completely understand that. That's happened to me. The unfortunate thing is that most of the sheeple out there will read the trashing of Linda Thompson and will believe the established media rather than investigate for themselves. I fight that battle constantly. I've been trashed over and over again to the point where I don't even pay any attention to it anymore. I just put my sight on the goal that I have, and I know the job that I have to do, and I just do that job no matter what.
This is the thing that amazed me, though. When I went down to Waco, I'm nobody. I'm just an attorney from Indiana that poked my nose into this stuff, and the reaction I got from the FBI was almost like an hysterical knee-jerk reaction. They immediately set about setting up situations where they could discredit me. This is an elaborate amount of things to do for somebody that's just nobody out of Indiana. They could have just ignored me, you know, and it would have been more effective.
Well, but
the very fact that they went to all this trouble to try to discredit me raised my eyebrows. It's like, well, gee, why are they so worried about me?
I'll tell you why, Linda. It's very clear, and it's even written in their plan, which I published in my book. They state very clearly that the biggest danger to their plan are individual people who can think and act with their own initiative and have no fear.
Well,
they are more afraid of people like you and I and many other people out there who fit this category than they are of anything else, because they can control the media, the establishment. Most people can be bought or scared. And so they don't fear those people. We're running out of time for this broadcast, and we got a lot more to talk about. Would you like to come back tomorrow night?
Sure, I'd love to.
Fantastic.
An amazing, very amazing, very brave woman, Linda Thompson. She'll be back with us tomorrow night, folks. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. You heard this broadcast tonight. I guarantee you tomorrow night will be just as absorbing and interesting. If you have not ordered that tape yet, order it now. You can order it directly from us. Directly from us. Send your order to William Cooper, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. That's William Cooper, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, spelled Sholow, Arizona, 85901. Now, the price of the tape, folks, is $20. We must have $5 for postage and handling, and we're relieving Linda and her organization of the burden of making these tapes because they just don't have the time to do it, folks. We are splitting this down the middle cost and whatever is left over after cost between us and her organization, and it will help both of our organizations. So please, if you have not ordered this tape, you must order it. You must see this tape. You must show it to everyone you know. You must make copies and get it out to everybody in the world if you possibly can. So send $25 to me and do it right now. Good night, folks, and God bless you all.